Greetings to all of you, honorable chairpersons, respected seniors and friends. I am an internist and I am proud to be an internist because that is the mother of all. I'm in tune with our governor, Professor Anuj Maheshwari's vision. I have chosen a topic on primary health care. And the topic that I have chosen today is a very common presentation. Acute chest pain. Not working. Acute chest pain, which is a very common presentation in the primary care. And I've seen it can break or make careers. I know a number of cases of doctors who are facing severe medical legal suit because they missed the diagnosis of an acute chest pain. So it is a very common complaint in the emergency department. 5% of all the emergency visits or 5 million visits per year. It has got a wide range of etiologies, and that is the problem where it is. Cardiac, pulmonary, GI, musculoskeletal. And it is very crucial to distinguish between these causes, not only to save the patient's life, but also to save the doctor himself from medical legal issues. Now, it is very important to remember in the initial stage, what are the causes of chest pain that can be fatal? Acute coronary syndromes, a pulmonary embolism, aortic dissection, esophageal rupture, pneumothorax, pneumonia with sepsis, and of course, there are others, pulmonary hypertension, myocarditis, and tamponade. But there are common benign causes of chest pain, like musculoskeletal, esophagitis, bronchitis, recently placed nipple rings, and the most common cause, non-specific chest pain, which basically means we don't know what it is, but it will not harm you. And fortunately for us, if you look at the top 10 causes of chest pain, irrespective of the age, non-specific chest pain is seen in more than 50% of the patients. So what do you, or what the primary care physician does in the first 60 seconds when the patient is brought to him? How does the patient look and what are the patient's vital signs? Now, what are the key emergency physicals? The general appearance, looking at the vital signs, the pulse, blood pressure, respiratory rate, the oxygen saturation, and of course now today, the fifth vital sign, blood sugar. What is the auscultation of the heart sound like? Muffled, regular, fast? Lungs, are they equal, wet, tympanic? Is there any jugular venous distension, abdominal distension? Any edema in the lower extremities or calf tenderness. History is very important. And unfortunately, that has become obsolete today in clinical practice. What is the location of the chest pain? Is it central, left or right? Are there any associated symptoms like breathlessness, sweating, nausea, vomiting? Timing, gradual or sudden onset? Are there any provocating factors? What is the quality? Is it visceral or somatic? And does it radiate to the neck, to the jaws, to the back? And what is the severity on a scale of 1 to 10? And then the rest of the history, the past medical history of the patient has been on any cardiac meds. Are there any allergies, which is very important? His social history, is a smoker, alcohol, drug abuse, family history, is there any family history of sudden death, early MI, deep vein thrombosis or pulmonary embolism? So the message is a focused history that includes characteristics and duration of symptoms in relation to the presentation, associated features, and CV risk assessment. In the next 5 minutes, what are the 3 bedside tests the physician should order? An ECG, a portable chest X-ray, and a high sensitive cardiac troponin. And what is the important chief medicine that can be given in cases of high suspicion of an acute coronary, a simple aspirin. But beware, rule out aortic dissection first. In the next 10 minutes, patient is stabilized. Initial data has been gathered, initial orders submitted. Then a secondary survey, more detailed history and physical examination to address the patient's pain. Is it chest wall pain, musculoskeletal? Is it pleuritic, respiratory in origin? Or is it visceral, cardiac in origin? The aim is to identify low-risk patients with chest pain who do not need additional testing beyond ECG and high sensitive cardiac troponin, and to identify with patients with chest pain most likely to benefit with further testing. So let's look at the case scenario. This gentleman, 46 years old male, non-diabetic, hypertensive, coronary artery, had MI 1 year. He comes again with a severe chest pain. Now we have to do an ECG immediately, and you can get various changes. You can get ST elevation, you can get new onset LVB. There may be changes of ischemia, strain pattern, or maybe non-specific T wave changes. But remember, a normal ECG does not rule out coronary artery disease. And high sensitivity cardiac troponin is today mandatory investigation. So the history, the ECG, the risk factor assessment, the physical examination, and a high sensitivity troponin. And you have to have some clinical decision pathways. There are many, but the one I chose, and I think is the most easy to remember, is what is called the HEART, which stands for mnemonic for history, ECG, age, risk factors, and the troponin. And then based on this assessment, you know whether the, what is the pre-test probability. If there's moderate risk, he may need further testing with like a stress echo or a CMR, cardiac magnetic resonance. Or if it is low risk, then we keep him under follow-up and do not investigate him further. Our patient had an acute ST elevation in lead 2, 3, and ABF, which is this thing, acute inferior wall infarction. The treatment is he should immediately go for to the cath lab, and a primary PCI should be done. X-ray showed mild congestion. Troponin was high. And if the PCI is not available, then at least give him thrombolytics. We must remember certain gender differences. Now, as far as the presentation is concerned, women will present most likely with associated symptoms like breathlessness, like dizziness, like palpitation, anxiety. And then, you know, Black women have a higher incidence of comorbidities like hypertension, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, etc. Now, another very important pathology, if you see, women are more likely to suffer from what is called as MINOCA, myocardial infarction with non-obstructive coronary arteries, or they can get a spontaneous coronary artery dissection. Fourth, psychological stress. Young women who have MI have a tremendous amount of psychosocial stress, and because of that, anxiety are likely to be missed. The diagnosis is likely to be missed, and they be labeled as hysterical or functional. Let's look at the second case. Here's a young man, 30 years old, had an open reduction internal fixation of an ankle fracture 2 weeks ago. You are called to see him, a sudden chest pain. This is nothing but acute pulmonary embolism. Now, what are the signs and symptoms, the risk factors? If you look at the risk factors, hypercoagulability, like pregnancy, estrogen use, the mutated factor 5 lesion, the protein C or S deficiency, venous stasis, like this patient had bed rest more than 48 hours, recent hospitalization, long distance travel, or venous injury like trauma or surgery. The diagnosis, symptoms of breathlessness, present in 90% cases, pleuritic chest pain in 66%, cough, and it is of sudden onset. Signs, tachycardia, tachypnea, hypoxia, and lower extremity swelling. Now, this is the classical ECG you will see. There is tachycardia, there is incomplete RBB, and there is simultaneously T wave inversion. But what is very classical is a deep S in lead 1 and a Q, narrow Q wave in lead 3 and inverted T in lead 3, known as the S1, Q3, T3 syndrome. And then the D dimer, very sensitive to low to moderate probability, not sensitive for high probability, not specific. Spiral CT is the current gold standard, quick and available. Ventilation perfusion scan can be indeterminate. Venous Doppler ultrasound is very important. Even in asymptomatic patients, if you can find and compression by ultrasonography, you can know the cause is there. Treatment, IV fluid to maintain blood pressure, heparin, either unfractionated or fractionated. Normally we give low molecular weight heparin. Fibrinolytics, not very well used, especially the large clot is there. No study or no benefits have been seen. Third case, A 35-year-old man with sudden ripping pain radiating to the back. Very interesting. This is nothing but aortic dissection. And you have to have a very high index of suspicion. And there is an intimal tear in the aorta, and the blood flows, and this direction can be anywhere in the aorta. So whom should you suspect aortic dissection? It's got a bimodal distribution, young connective tissues, especially if they're having Marfan syndrome in pregnancy, or older, most commonly more than 50 years. Risk factors, 66% are males, 72% are hypertensive, 30% have Marfan's disease, cocaine use, syphilis, etc. And clinical features, 85% have a chest pain or a back pain, is the ripping or tearing in 50%, neurological symptoms in 20%, hematuria, asymptomatic pulses. But you must have a very high index of suspicion, and you must always rule out aortic dissection, because if you treat it as acute coronary, it will be disastrous. So the diagnosis, chest X-ray, you can see a widened mediastinum, but not very chest CT is very sensitive and specific and can be easily obtained nowadays. Angiography, of course, is the gold standard, but it gives you the anatomy, but may not be available everywhere. And med sound, ultrasound to evaluate and look for the tamponade. This is the classical DeBakey involvement. In DeBakey 1, it is both the ascending and descending that is involved. In DeBakey 2, it is the ascending part of aorta is involved. And DeBakey 3 is the descending. Now, why it is important to know? Because the treatment is going to differ. When you're managing this patient, it is very important to involve a cardiothoracic surgeon as early as possible. So you must maintain a blood pressure of around 120 by 80. Beta blockers are the first line of choice. We can add nitroprusside or vasodilators. Patient must be in the ICU and his blood pressure should be monitored. Case scenario 4. Here's this gentleman who wants to do research on alcohol. Now he presents with persistent vomiting with sudden onset of chest pain followed by hemorrhage. Now what is this disease? Spontaneous esophageal rupture or Bourhave syndrome. And you can see the air shadows on the X-ray, the air shadows on the X-ray and the subcutaneous emphysema. Very easy. Now, esophagus is more vulnerable to rupture because it lacks a serosal layer. And once perforation occurs, because the gastric contents come in, it is mediastinitis. It can lead to sepsis, septicemia, and then the gastric fluid is drawn and there is subcutaneous emphysema. Now, perforations are usually longitudinal. Left side is more common. And the classical thing, subcutaneous emphysema, tachypnea, and abdominal rigidity. This is known as the Anderson triad, which is commonly seen in this patient. The investigation of choice is CT esophagography. The esophagoduodenogastroscopy is contraindicated. Case scenario 5. Young 18 years, healthy male, he was lifting weights when he suddenly has onset of chest pain and breathlessness. He's having tachycardia, tachypnea, low blood pressure, all in saturation, decreased breath sounds on the left. Diagnosis, what did you do first? This is nothing but tension pneumothorax. Just put in a needle at the site and the second intercostal space and you cure the patient. Last case, pneumonia with pleurisy. Here is the normal lung, and on the other side, you see an inflamed lung here, and you see this thing, the pleura, inflamed pleura, and pneumothorax on the other side. So pleurisy is basically inflammation of the pleura. It can present chest pain, cough, fever, etc. Viral infection is the commonest cause, but it can be bacterial, pulmonary embolism, others. Autoimmune disease also, and many times we don't know what is the cause of pleurisy. We treat them as on an antitubercular treatment. Differential diagnosis of pericarditis, MI, cholecystitis, pneumothorax. Now chest X-ray and blood test can be done. Treatment depends on the underlying cause. Simple NSAIDs or paracetamol and incentive spirometry is important. So coming to the algorithm of how to approach a patient with chest pain. Chest pain may be constant or intermittent. If it is constant, is it with significant hypertension or without significant hypertension? In patients without significant hypertension, is it relieved with antacids? Then it is most probably esophagitis or hiatal hernia. If it is not relieved with antacids, is there hemoptysis or no hemoptysis? With hemoptysis, is most likely to be pulmonary embolism. Without hemoptysis, if there is a fever and purulent sputum, it is pneumonia. Without fever and purulent sputum, it can be either aggravated by movement, then it is pericarditis. If it is not aggravated by movement, it is MI, panic disorder, or hyperventilation syndrome. If it is associated with significant hypertension, it is most likely to be an MI, dissecting aneurysm, or drug abuse. If it is intermittent, precipitated, or increased by breathing, then it is most likely to be pleurisy, fractured ribs, costochondritis, or pneumothorax. And if it is intermittent, not affected by breathing, but relieved by nitroglycerides, less than 2 minutes, angina pectoris, more than 2 minutes, coronary insufficiency. So the take home, it is very important to remember that the initial goal in the emergency is to identify life threats. Although most patients will not have a cardiac cause, the evaluation of all patients should focus on the early identification or exclusion of life-threatening causes. In all patients of chest pain, do not forget to examine the abdomen, and in abdominal pain, do not forget to examine the chest. Remember, airways, breathing, circulation are always first. The take-home message is from the Journal of Cardiology, from the American College of Cardiology, which is a mnemonic to stand from the chest pain. C, chest pain means more than pain in the chest. H, high sensitivity troponins are now mandatory. Early care is very important. The shared decision-making should be there. You should tell the patient what you are thinking. And testing is not routinely needed in low patients and low probability patients. P, pathways, use clinical decision pathways. The heart I talked about. Accompanying symptoms, as I said, women are more likely to have accompanying symptoms. Identify patients most likely to benefit from further testing. Non-cardiac pain is the word to be used. Atypical or non-specific is out. And lastly, structured risk assessment should be used in all patients. Thank you for a patient hearing.